How do you do? I am Paul Garber. It is my privilege to be the historian emeritus for the National Air and Space Museum at the Smithsonian Institution in Washington. And I'm pleased to bring you another of the series on the history of flight, part two of the Wright brothers. I want to emphasize the significance of this wonderful photograph. This occasion that you are seeing was the first time in the history of the world that a machine heavier than air, not a balloon, not an airship, heavier than air, carrying a man, had risen from the ground under its own power, had flown forward under control, without reduction of speed, and had landed without wreckage at a point equally as high as that from which it had started. Now, that very excellent definition of what constitutes true flight is the best setting forth of the principles that constitute practical aviation. There are many other persons for whom the first flight was claimed. Oh, Whitehead in Connecticut, Adair in France, Maxim in England, Santos Dumont in Brazil, Jethro in Germany, each one deserving his place. But when you take their claims for the first flight and sift those through that definition, none can equal the qualifications that the Wright brothers did possess, and they remain preeminent as the first to fly. That definition is contained in the first article prepared by Orville and Wilbur Wright. It appeared in the Century magazine for September 1908 and is an excellent article for all of you to read. You will enjoy it. You will benefit from it, as I did. There were four flights made that day of December 17, 1903. The first, with Orville at the controls, was for 12 seconds, a distance of about 120 feet, 10 feet per second. The second by Wilbur, about 175 feet. The third by Orville, the brothers alternating, was a similar distance. But the fourth by Wilbur was 852 feet in 59 seconds. He really got up and flew that thing. But in the landing, which was abrupt, well, nobody had ever flown an airplane before. There were no books on this, no training lessons. They had to teach themselves. And each flight ended as a wingtip would touch some little bit of ground. But in that landing by Wilbur, there was some damage. And they took the aircraft back to the hangar, and there had taken off the front elevator member, and were going to repair it. Now, the wind was very strong that day, 27 miles an hour. And as they were talking about the flight and working on this repair, the wind got under those wings, and all of a sudden the aircraft was raised up and then over and then over and over and over, just like a box kite with a broken string. And it was impossible to repair it at that time, so the brothers decided to pack up and go on home in time for Christmas. But first, they wanted to send a telegram to their father. In fact, they'd planned to fill the gasoline tank all the way and fly over to the telegraph station. But they walked over, and there they did send this telegram. Success. Four flights Thursday morning. All against a 21-mile wind, actually 27. Started from the level with engine power alone. Average speed through the air, 31 miles. Longest, 57 seconds, really 59. Informed the press, home Christmas, signed by Orville Wright. Well, the telegrapher had mixed up a couple of figures there. But when the father received this, he gave it to his daughter and said, hurry on down to the newspaper and tell them this wonderful news. Well, the Dayton Journal had but recently heard about some flights made by a Zeppelin airship from Friedrichshafen to Stuttgart, or some 60 miles or so. And he thought, well, what does a 57-second flight got to do with anything of importance? And so the Dayton Journal had nothing at all. In fact, well, the Virginia Pilot newspaper did have a very flamboyant article, quite incorrect, but that was copied here and there, came out of the New York Herald about a month later, and a very flamboyant description of things that just could not be, said the flight had been for 3 miles, and this picture shows a propeller underneath to push it up. But even so, it was publicity. And yet, then it subsided, and the world forgot all about Wilbur and Orville Wright. Well, they no longer had the need, you see, for the high hills and the strong winds and the soft sand there at Kitty Hawk. And so, near their home in Dayton, Ohio, they obtained the use of a field about 7 miles away called Huffman's Prairie. Now, Wilbur made this sketch several years later to show some friends where it was. And you see that large oval there with a hangar up there at the top. And there was a streetcar line that ran on one side of the field and a public road on the other. Persons who say the Wright brothers practiced in private just didn't realize the facts. But there at Huffman's Prairie, the Wright brothers first set up a rig similar to that which they had had at Kitty Hawk. That is the long rail for takeoff. And yet, in the summertime, you see the air doesn't have the buoyancy, doesn't have the depth, the body, as it does in the winter. So summer air didn't have the same strength. And thus the Wright brothers decided they needed more push to get off the ground. So they contrived a catapult. Now over here at the right, you see that tower. That tower had a weight that was pulled up to the top. I can show that better in a drawing. And thank you. Here at the top of the tower was that heavy weight, and then a line on that weight went up to the top over a pulley, down that front leg, way over here to your left, over the end of the track where there was another pulley, and then the line went to the front of the airplane. Then you see, when the weight came down, the airplane was pulled forward and thus into the air. Now that was first tried on September the 4th of 1904. There's Wilbur up there attaching the fittings for the pulley tackle, and there's the heavy weight there on the ground. Now, actually, this picture was taken a few years later, but it shows what I'm trying to illustrate. The use of this catapult for takeoff. We all know today you've got to have more gun to get off the ground than you do to stay up there. So in 1904, they made 105 flights, the longest over 5 minutes. That was on September 20, when for the first time they flew out and back. Now these others I spoke of, these other experimenters over there in Europe, they've made little bounces off the ground, but in a straight line. But the Wright brothers there on September 20 flew out and back in big circles and in figure eights, gaining good control of this aircraft. The next year, 1905, they flew for more than half an hour, a flight of 24.2 miles in 38.5 minutes. This was such an excellent accomplishment that the Wright brothers then wrote to the War Department and said, well, we've perfected an airplane that we'd like to demonstrate to you. We think it has military possibilities. We'd be very pleased to show it to you. The War Department paid no attention, just sent them a form letter saying that, well, it wasn't at all helpful, just saying that demonstrations had to be given. The Wright brothers had already asked for that. But here, they did receive their patent in 1906. They'd applied for it in 1903. And this patent is another thing I want to emphasize to you. This was not merely a patent for lift. Aircraft had been lifting since the first kite 3,000 years ago. Things had been steering since the Chinese put a rudder on a boat, maybe another 3,000 before that. But the patent of the Wright brothers was for the combination of balance, lateral balance, and the control of yaw. Yaw is that tendency of an aircraft to sort of slew around in flight. But by the addition of that rear vertical surface and the manipulation in connection with lateral balance, the Wright brothers did develop the basic elements of true flight. It's interesting to see what the rest of the world is trying to do during this period. There was Vuya of Bulgaria, who had made this very interesting aircraft. This is preserved today in the French Musée de l'Air at Charlemont in France. You should go over there and see it. It has an Antoinette engine, and it barely skipped along the ground. Maybe the tracks got a bit light. Here is Ellehammer in Denmark. And this, rose about a foot and flew about 100 feet, but it was tethered to a post so that some of that lift could have been centrifugal. Then there was Alberto Santos Dumont of Brazil. He was in France, and he, as you see, rose, a bit and went about 80-some feet, and then later on went about 200 feet. These were the first flights officially witnessed by representatives of the Fédération Aéronautique Internationale in Paris, and thus Santos Dumont is often credited as the first to fly. But it was not until the end of 1907, as you see here, that anyone else flew an airplane as much as a minute. And yet the Wright brothers had flown more than half an hour back there in 1905. Now the efforts with the War Department continued to be frustrating. The Wright brothers had hoped that our own country would be interested, but there was very little response. In the meanwhile, other countries were becoming interested. Russia and France and England and Germany. And so in 1907, Wilbur went to France and tried to make some arrangements for demonstrations. Then Orville followed and tried to help with these. Then Orville was asked by Wilbur to prepare one of their airplanes for demonstrations abroad, but it just lay in customs while all of these negotiations were going forward. But now, in the meanwhile, there was a plan to have a meeting of all the navies of the world down at Hampton Roads. And the Wright brothers thought, well, nobody believes we can fly. All of these efforts to get together with these governments are so frustrating and disappointing. Let's go back to Kitty Hawk, they said. Let's put floats on our aircraft and see if we can't fly off Albemarle Sound, and then we'll fly over those vessels, and certainly the fleets of the world will be impressively convinced that an airplane does exist and that we can fly it. Well, they never did complete this experiment. Here you see them on the Miami River near Dayton. They had, incidentally, I want to emphasize that they used hydrofoils on those floats. Now, you think hydrofoils are new? Well, they were invented in 1905 by Forlanini in Italy. But the Wright brothers here, just 2 or 3 years later, had learned about them and put them on these floats. They got some lift, but they gave up these experiments before they were completed because France did show some positive interest. But the Wright brothers hadn't flown since 1905. So they went back to Kitty Hawk. And there, this photograph, quite retouched, was taken by Jimmy Hare of Collier's Magazine. And the article by Byron Newton described how these Wright brothers actually did fly. Those reporters lay there sort of in ambush. The Wright brothers knew they were there, but the reporters didn't know the Wright brothers did. And they took this picture and they made this drawing, which shows that for the first time, they were sitting up. And there, also for this first time, is a passenger carried in an airplane. The passenger is Charlie Furness, one of the Wright brothers' mechanics. And these flights were very helpful in regaining their skill, teaching a new method of control. You recall that previously they had lain prone. And so with this new experience, this new practice, Wilbur then went to France. He got that airplane out of customs, which Orville had sent over the previous year, and he had this shed constructed for him. Mr. Hart O'Berg was his very good friend over there, and this shed was much like the one he'd had at Kitty Hawk, the one out at Huffman's Prairie, and Wilbur lived in that shed. He didn't go at home to some hotel at night. He lived there. He had his galley over there in the corner. He had a bunk, some kind of a canvas bed. And he lived and worked and lived until he got the job finished. But in the meanwhile, these French thought that he was just bluffing. They thought, well, look at all the wonderful flights that our persons have made, and yet this Wilbur Wright is just a bluffer. So this was called Le Bluffeur. And there were other criticisms that were not at all complimentary. But Wilbur kept on working, and then came the day when he brought the aircraft completed, repaired, ready to fly. I said repaired because there had been some damage to it while it was in customs. Orville later thought somebody had gotten into that box and was responsible for the damage that Wilbur complained about in the packing. But here is the aircraft repaired, brought out, the rear rudder put on, the front elevator put on, all ready for these demonstrations. Now, these were to take place at Le Mans. Le Mans is about 30 miles, I was told, outside of Paris. Later, they went down to Pau, which was a warmer section of that country. But here's Wilbur, he's got those beams, those tuba fours, maybe that's a tuba six, that he's gonna lay in a line for that launching track. And then he's gonna climb up there in the tower, make that all rigged up, get that ready for the weight. Here he is fixing up the lines by which the aircraft is to be catapulted into the air. And then the aircraft was brought out, placed upon the track. There it is being moved out. Now we have a wonderful motion picture here, the first ever made of an airplane in flight. And I'm so pleased that through the help of National Archives and this wonderful crew here in the Navy, the two Jims, that we can show it to you. There's Wilbur putting a wheel under that wing, a wheel under the other wing, and thus it is just rolled over the ground. Those wheels were just for temporary use. Now here's a working party. In fact, persons later considered it a great honor to help pull that weight up. There's a passenger seated, because you see Wilbur was going to take passengers over there also and teach persons to fly, starting the engine by getting those propellers on compression, and then down she goes, and there goes the weight, and there goes the aircraft, and into the air. There were hundreds, thousands of persons came to see these flights. These were astounding. They were the greatest news of the day, just as later on we had the news of the trip up there to the moon. And these flights, about 35 miles an hour. Well, a short film, but very impressive, and I'm so glad we had it. Now, the first of Wilbur's passengers was Mr. Zenz, a noted balloonist of that time. Interesting to look at that control. Wilbur's left hand controls the front elevator. His right hand controls the rudder when he pulls it back and forth, and then controls the wing warping as he moves the lever from side to side. No safety belts, just sort of sit there and hope you're kept in by the wind pressure, then off into the air. Now, Mrs. Harto Berg is said to be the first woman ever to fly in an airplane. She was the wife of the man who had made the arrangements for Wilbur over there in France. I want to call the lady's attention to that very modest bit there. This line has been tied around her dress at the ankles. It was just terrible back in 1908 to show an ankle. Later on, when I became a little older, why, ankles were no longer a mystery. But in those days, women were a bit more modest. And again, you see the method of control with Wilbur's hands. She made a flight that she enjoyed a great deal. And as Wilbur continued to fly, this news came to the ears of royalty. Now, you always hear about a royal command requiring a person to go to see that royal person. But here's the King of Spain coming there to France to see Wilbur. The King of Spain there at the right with the hat on, very interested in all that he was witnessing. Wilbur was showing him how the engine operated, how the controls were working, and the king wanted to take a flight. In fact, he got as far as that front seat. But about that time, the queen said no. So poor Alphonse never got his flight. And yet he was so impressed, as was the king, King Edward of England, who also saw the Wright brothers fly, and the king of Italy, as you'll learn when I give the next part of this story. So, in the meanwhile, now, James Gordon Bennett, the editor of the New York Herald, had originated a number of prizes for competitions and transportation. The James Gordon Bennett Balloon Prize was won by Frank Lahm, whom you see there at the left. He was Lieutenant Frank Lahm, United States Army, Cavalry. His companion was Major Hersey, and they did win that first James Gordon Bennett race. But in the meanwhile, Frank Lahm and his father were learning about the work of the Wright brothers. And it was so impressive to them. They were so proud of these Americans. And so they interceded with Theodore Roosevelt and urged that the Wright brothers be permitted to demonstrate their airplane in America, even though the War Department had not shown the interest. So Theodore Roosevelt directed his Secretary of War to get on the beam. Specifications were written, and bids were let out. In fact, 41 persons responded. They thought the Wrights would be the only one, but 41 persons responded at various prices, one of $1 million. Well, the Wright brothers bid $25,000, and the contract was awarded to them. So then, Orville was to give those demonstrations at Fort Myer, while Wilbur was giving his demonstrations in France. And here is one of those specifications being fulfilled, that the airplane had to be sufficiently portable to be carried from one place to another on an ordinary army wagon. There's Orville on the running board of that car. The craft is coming up the hill there at Fort Myer, and then was to go across the drill field, where at that time, as you'll see, the Army was experimenting with balloons. In fact, the Army had used balloons as far back as the Civil War. And We're going to tell that in another one of these parts. Also, the Army was interested in an airship. And this airship had been made by Thomas Baldwin. And the power was provided by Glenn Curtis of Hammondsport. I'll be mentioning him a little further on. And this airship was quite successful. The flights by it were in July. Well, now here we are, September, early part of September in 1908, the airplane being unloaded into the hangar there where it was assembled. Orville supervising the mechanics, Charlie Furness and Charlie Taylor, getting a hand from the men of the Signal Corps there. And then it was brought across the field, again using those temporary wheels, as you saw, being taken over to the catapult, the launching tower. Again, there were thousands of persons there to see these flights. Uh-oh, look out, girls, get out of the way. There's that miniskirt of 1908, demonstrated by these two ladies who were in the way at the moment. Then over to the launching rail, and you can see at the left the tower, and the launching track is underneath, and then the aircraft was being adjusted, ready for takeoff. There's the takeoff. The first one was on September the 3rd. And then, you see, part of these specifications required that a passenger must be carried, and also that the craft be able to fly for an hour. Well, Lieutenant Lahm, now there at Fort Myer, and shown here with Glenn Curtis, who made the engine for that airship that you saw, Frank Lahm was to be the first military passenger. And on September 9, Orville first went up for a flight of 57 minutes and 25 seconds. Then on his next flight, he flew for an hour, 2 minutes and 15 seconds, the first time in the world that an airplane had flown for more than an hour at Fort Myer. In fact, sometime when you go to Fort Myer, Virginia, you'll see at the reviewing stand a plaque there, a bronze plaque, that my wife and I provided through the Early Birds organization. That's a bunch of old-time flyers. And on there, we've listed all these famous firsts of aviation at Fort Myer. Well, then, on September 9, Lahm became the first passenger, military passenger, to fly, and the duration was 6 minutes and 24 seconds. 6 minutes, 24 seconds, a world record with a passenger. Then, on the 12th of September, the passenger was to be Major Squire. Major Squire, standing there with his back to us. Now notice that flag on the front strut there of the elevator. That had been given to Orville by Mrs. Winfield Scott Klein. She became wife of the photographer, and later they gave that flag to the National Air and Space Museum. Not the first flag to be flown, because back in 1904, when Roosevelt was elected, the Wright brothers had flown a flag on their airplane at Huffman's Prairie. But now there's Major Squire. He's going to be the next passenger. And on the date of September 12th, he did have a flight for 9 minutes and 6 seconds. That was another world record. Meanwhile, of course, Wilbur was making those flights with passengers in France. Now, on the 17th of September, the passenger was to be Thomas Ethelyn Selfridge, the gentleman in the foreground, and he is with Alexander Graham Bell, inventor of the telephone. Now, Dr. Bell had been interested in aviation for many years. Up at his summer home in Bedeck, Nova Scotia, he had developed a series of kites, and then, having brought together a group of men who consist here of Casey Baldwin, now he's no relation to the airship Baldwin, he's to the left, then Lieutenant Selfridge, in the center is Glenn Curtis, who had been brought in to make the engines. Curtis was a very capable maker of excellent motorcycles. And these motorcycles had been seen by Baldwin, and an engine had been seen by Bell, and thus Curtis was under contract with Baldwin to make engines for the airships, and with Bell, an associate, to make the engines for their airplanes. In fact, Bell first tried the Curtis engine on a large kite, but the kite didn't get off. So then, at the right there was McCurdy, who was carrying a crutch because he'd tried out one of Curtis's motorcycles. Well, now, Selfridge had the honor of designing the first airplane. They called it the Red Wing because there was quite a lot of red silk left over from some of Dr. Bell's kites. And this was tried first in March. It went up rather steeply and came down rather hard. They had left out one very important element, and that was lateral control. They had lift. They had an elevator there for raising it. You see that there in the front. Also had an elevating surface at the rear. And then they had that vertical surface for steering at the rear. So the aircraft got off, but it did not have control. That was a very essential element. So Selfridge wrote to the Wright brothers and asked for information about lateral control. The Wright brothers wrote a very courteous reply and suggested that he study their patent. Now, the next aircraft was designed by Casey Baldwin. They called this the White Wing. They had run out of red cloth, probably. And in this one, Selfridge did fly. That was in May the 19th of 1908. Thus, you see, the first time in the history of the world that a military officer had piloted an airplane, Thomas Ethelyn Selfridge. Well, now, this fine young man was to have this marvelous experience of flying with one of the two greatest pilots of that day, Orville and Wilbur Wright. This picture was taken by Carl Claudy, a Masonic friend of mine, and Carl told me, as he gave it to me, he said, when I snapped this picture, Selfridge called to me, look out, Carl, we're just about to take off. Well, they did. The weight dropped, the rope pulled, they went forward and into the air. Well, they'd made four circuits of the field and were just about at this point over that hangar there in the corner when, as Orville later said, he heard a clickety-clackety sound. And he glanced back hurriedly. He saw that something had broken. Well, a piece of propeller had broken. Later it was picked up, found there on the ground, and you see from that piece of propeller how it had struck a wire. And if we can have just a little bit of the top of it there, you'll see where the wire had gouged into it. Well, as the propeller broke the wire, pulled the wire loose from that connection. And, of course, this happened so fast, it, much faster than I can describe it. But it pulled that wire loose. Now, that wire led over to the vertical rudder at the back. And without the tension of that wire, that rudder lay over and became a horizontal surface and nosed the craft over into a crash. September 17, 1908. Now, in that crash, Orville was badly injured. And, oh, he suffered injuries to his hip and ribs. In fact, for the rest of his life, he suffered from that. He recovered in about 7 weeks. But Selfridge had sustained a concussion. He never regained consciousness, and he died in 2 hours. Selfridge thus became the first sacrifice to powered aviation. Such a sad paradox that the first military officer to fly should be the first military officer to give his life for aviation. Had he lived, no doubt the whole science of flight would have benefited. Very fine young man. He's buried now over in Arlington, Virginia, in the National Cemetery there. I often go over there to visit his grave. In fact, the early birds think of that place as sort of a shrine of aviation. And we can regret his death, and yet we are so grateful for his life, because he certainly, while he lived, did advance aviation a great deal. Aviation has had its losses and its great gains, and we of the public are those who benefit from the progress that has been made. Thanks to Orville and Wilbur Wright, we do have the beginnings of flight and great advancements in progress as our story
You'll
continues.
You'll recall that when we were previously together, I was telling you about Thomas Ethelyn Selfridge, the first man who died in an airplane crash, September 17, 1908. Flying as a passenger with Orville Wright at Fort Myer, Virginia, September 17, 1908, Selfridge suffered a concussion in the crash of the Wright airplane. He died about 2 hours later. He is buried in the National Cemetery at Arlington, Virginia, within a short distance of the place where the airplane fell. This monument was erected by his family. As I visit his grave in that beautiful cemetery where many of our national heroes and some of my dear friends are lying, I realize that death is an inevitable adventure that all of us must come to someday. But it is what we accomplish while we are living that matters. And surely Thomas Selfridge had a wonderful career. Born in California in 1882, He graduated from West Point in 1903. As I told you in our previous program, he became, on May 19, 1908, the first military officer in the world to pilot an airplane. He also learned to pilot the Signal Corps No. 1, our Army's first dirigible airship. The tablet on his monument reads, First Lieutenant Thomas E. Selfridge, 1st Regiment Field Artillery, U.S. Army, killed in the service of the United States in an aerodrome accident, September 17, 1908, aged 26. Following the crash, Orville Wright was in the hospital at Fort Myer for 7 weeks, then recuperated further at home in Dayton, Ohio. Meanwhile in France, Wilbur demonstrated with convincing capability that the unfortunate crash at Fort Myer had not been due to any aerodynamic fault of the airplane. The one he was flying was similar to that which Orville had flown at Fort Myer. Just 4 days after his brother's accident, Wilbur, flying alone, made a world's duration record of 1 hour, 7 minutes, and 24 seconds. Then followed 4 successive world record flights with passengers, the longest being for 1 hour, 9 minutes, and 45 1/5 seconds. On December 18, he made a flight record alone of 1 hour and 54 minutes and an altitude record of about 377 feet. On December 31, he made an astounding record of 2 hours, 20 minutes, and 23 1/5 seconds. During the total period of his flights in France in 1908, Wilbur made more than 100 flights. In January 1909, Orville, accompanied by their sister Catherine, joined Wilbur in Paris, where they went on some sightseeing together. During the winter months, Wilbur had moved his flight demonstrations to the warmer southern part of France, and there King Edward VII of England came to see Wilbur fly. Also at Pau, France, Catherine enjoyed a flight with her brother. Orville was standing just to the left outside of the picture as the airplane was being ready for takeoff. In April, the three of them went to Italy, where further demonstrations were to be made. Here the airplane is being hauled through the streets of Rome on the way to a large open area which is now part of the flying field of Centicelle. There, King Victor Emmanuel showed enthusiastic interest in the airplane. We are pleased that His Highness was also interested in photography because from the camera that His equerry is carrying, we have several of these photographs that you are seeing. His Highness did not take a flight, but he asked numerous questions about the mechanism and operation. A very interesting motion picture film was made in Italy, including a portion taken with a camera located directly behind the pilot and showing his manipulation of the front control. Here's the hangar. Many, many persons came to see these wonderful flights, the airplane coming out, being moved on temporary wheels that are placed under the wing so it can be rolled to the starting rail. You recall that this long starting rail was part of a catapult system by which the airplane was given its initial velocity to supplement the power of the engine. There's Wilbur just at the left for a moment. The front end of the airplane is to the right, a bit confusing because today the tail is at the back. Propellers, you see, are at the rear. The engine started by cranking both props, pulling down on the outside blade. There's Wilbur with one of his passengers. He carried about 20 passengers during the 40-some flights that he made there near Rome, along the starting rail and into the air. A wonderful, wide-open area, quite historic because in some of these scenes you can see the old Roman aqueducts in the distance. Around and around that huge field, there's those aqueducts. The speed about 40 miles an hour, altitude, as you see, about 75 to 100 feet, sometimes about 150. The camera was hand-cranked, and so the speeds will seem to vary as the operator may have gotten a bit tired turning that crank all the time. Here, he's going to give the cameraman a pretty close shave. Large number of officers there. There's Orville with that straw hat on. Balloons were used at that time by a number of armies. Airplane under perfect control. Now we're going to get a real, there goes your hat, real thrill. You notice how the airplane seems to sort of hunt up and down. Of course, close to the ground, there are air currents that are sometimes rather bumpy. Another approach. Speed, as I say, about 40 miles an hour. The revolutions of the propeller will seem to vary in the movie. See how slowly they seem to go, but that's because of the synchronization with the motion picture film. About 350 RPM. Now, you're just about to see, for the first time ever taken, movies during an airplane in flight with a camera mounted behind the seats, pointing out forward between the pilot and passenger. Now, along the rail, a very interesting thing here is that string that's tied to that upright stick there. You see it every now and then more clearly than at others. Now, that is an instrument. Today we have hundreds of instruments on our control panels, but that string was just about the first instrument. And as it waved toward the pilot, he could tell whether he was climbing or descending by the way that it would fly sort of upward or downward. And if it sort of waved to one side or another, he knew he was drifting, either right or left, or had a cross current. It's a darn good instrument. Very simple and quite informative to the pilot. There's some of those aqueducts in the distance. Notice how the airplane seems to go up and down with constant manipulation of that elevator in front. That's one of the features of those types that have the elevator in front. Wilbur made 42 flights in Italy, including a number with passengers. On 23 of these flights, he gave instruction to three officers, Lieutenant Mario Calderara of the Italian Navy, Lieutenant Umberto Savoia, and Captain Castagnieres Guido. The arrangements for these flights had been made by the United States Ambassador to Italy, Lloyd Griscom, who very graciously gave me these photographs, including this beautiful scene of the airplane flying at sunset. This photograph was inscribed to the Ambassador and Mrs. Griscom by Wilbur, Orville, and Catherine. Orville's health had improved during his visit to Europe and further benefited from the two-week ocean voyage back to the United States. Back home in Dayton, they received a welcoming ovation, a parade and presentation of medals from Congress, from the state of Ohio, and from the city of Dayton. On that same day as the parade, June 18, the airplane which they had constructed as a replacement for the one which had crashed 9 months previous arrived at Fort Myer, and the brothers and sister followed soon after. Here they are at Fort Myer, Wilbur at the left standing beside one of their mechanics, Charlie Taylor, Orville at the right talking to his sister and to her close friend, Mrs. Ralph Van Diemen, of whom you will hear more a bit later. This painting by Colonel Jack McCoy, U.S. Air Force artist, shows the general scene. The airplane, except for the engine and chain transmission, was all new construction, generally similar to the 1908 machine, but 4 feet less in span in order to increase its speed. In this scene, Wilbur has a Signal Corps flag, which he would wave at Orville while flying to inform him about the progress of his flights. Orville is standing there in front, nearest to us, on the right side, and Lieutenants Frank Lam and Benjamin Folloy, who were to be the military passengers in separate flights. At the right is a little lad, 10 years old. He's of particular interest to me because that is I. From my personal recollections of one of those flights at Fort Myer, I'd been able to help the artist, and in turn, he painted me into the picture, helping one of the photographers, Winfield Scott Klein, carry part of his camera gear. Mr. Klein gave us some of these pictures. Another photographer there was Carl Claudy, who was also very generous in helping me with preparing these lectures. The airplane had been assembled and its engine tested in this hangar, located at the southern end of the large drill field. And now, thanks to a motion picture photographer who went from the Department of Agriculture, carrying his large wooden boxed Edison camera over there, we have this first motion picture made in America of an airplane. Now, that's not the airplane in the foreground. That large object is President William Howard Taft, weighed about 320 pounds. And He was accompanied by a number of his cabinet, ambassadors, officials of government. Just about everybody would go over there to see these flights. I read about them in the paper, and I'm so glad that I went over the following year. This is in 1908, however, that you're seeing now. Not 1909 this is, yes. You can always tell the difference by the higher landing gear. Now, Orville will be coming along in just a moment. Hurry up, Orville. There he goes. And here he is with his passenger, Lieutenant Lahm, Frank P. Lahm. The date is July 27, because that was the date of the Endurance flight, the one that I saw. Orville ducked under all those wires to get into his seat. Now, just beneath him, there's a thing that a sailor calls a pelican hook. It's a means whereby a tension can be released to let the airplane go forward. There's Wilbur with that straw hat on, Charlie Taylor in shirt sleeves. That's the catapult tower. A heavy weight, 1,200 pounds, is to be hoisted up to the top of the tower. There's the men pulling on the line. Up goes the weight. And Wilbur gives it a push with his cane. Now, as that weight comes down with the engine running, a line fastened to the weight and extending out to the end of this rail and back to the airplane, the weight comes down, the line goes, line pulls, the airplane goes forward and into the air. The flights were made around the field. Orville had said that that was quite the smallest field he'd ever flown in. Of course, down there at Kitty Hawk, they had all the Atlantic seaboard, and out in Ohio, they had the whole flat state. But here, they were limited on one side by a cemetery wall, not a very cheerful barrier, and then the horse stables for the artillery and cavalry were over there on the right side, as you see. Speed, about 40 miles an hour. Propeller RPMs, about 350, similar to the airplane flown by Wilbur in France and in Italy. The method of landing was to reach overhead and pull a wire which stopped the compression of the engine, and then you sort of skid on in to a landing. The duration flight was made, as I say, on the 27th of July. That was the flight which I saw. Lieutenant Frank P. Lahm was the passenger. They circled the field 79 and a half times at a maximum height of 150 feet. The official requirement was for a flight of an hour, and this flight of 1 hour, 12 minutes, 37 and one-fifth seconds constituted a new world record with a passenger. For the speed test, held on July 30, the passenger was Lieutenant Benjamin Foloy, who had surveyed a five-mile course extending from Fort Myer to Alexandria, Virginia. The Wrights hoped to attain as much speed as possible above the required 40 miles per hour because they were to receive a bonus of 10% for each mile above that speed. There was a quartering wind which reduced the airspeed in both directions. A balloon marker was raised above the turning point in Alexandria. The line for this balloon was tied to a large rock. That rock was the cornerstone of the National Masonic Memorial on top of Shooter's Hill. Today, the monument forms a turning point for airplanes coming into land at the Washington National Airport. The speed attained in the official test on April 30 of 1909 was a trifle more than 42 and a half miles per hour. The signal corps did not allow for the fraction, and on the basis of the original contract price of $25,000, the brothers received an extra $5,000. By the middle of August, Orville was aboard ship for Europe. There he gave demonstrations in Germany to officials of the German government. He carried passengers, gave instructions to several army officers. On October 2nd, his passenger was the Crown Prince. On October 15th, he flew before Kaiser Wilhelm, who may well have been thinking how such a mechanism might be used in warfare, anticipating World War I, which began 5 years later. Meanwhile, the Hudson Fulton Exposition opened in New York City, commemorating the trips up the river by Hendrik Hudson in 1607 and Fulton two centuries later. A modern contrast was to be demonstrations of an airplane over the river at Manhattan. Governor's Island was the takeoff area. And in this hangar, Wilbur assembled his airplane. Here he is adjusting one of the propellers. Because he was to fly above the water and wanted some way of floating in the event of an engine failure, he fastened a canoe between the skids. The airplane was towed out to the launching rail by a detail of soldiers from the Army post. On September 29, Wilbur made a spectacular flight around the Statue of Liberty. And on October 4, now there's that Statue of Liberty picture. That's faked, obviously, because I couldn't find one with a canoe in it. But I assure you, he carried the canoe on the official flight. The route that was the most famous of those flights there at Manhattan is shown in this slide. The route extended from Governor's Island above the river as far as Grant's Tomb in Upper Manhattan and returned. The view of the airplane in flight that you see here was made by a passenger on a ferry boat. Here the skyline of skyscrapers forms the background, and here is the return flight. More than a million New Yorkers thus got their first view of an airplane flying. The distance over the water was 21 miles. Wilbur had planned a flight over the city itself, but a cylinder head damage canceled further demonstrations there. One of the stipulations of the contract with the Signal Corps was that two Army officers were to be taught to fly. The drill field at Fort Myer was too small for such training, and Lieutenant Lom had found a larger, more suitable area at College Park, Maryland, about 10 miles north of Fort Myer. A temporary hangar was built there, and Wilbur arrived October 5. Lom and Foloy, who had been passengers for the official flights at Fort Myer, were designated to receive instruction. But Foloy was sent to Europe to attend an international congress of aeronautics at Nancy, France. So Second Lieutenant Frederick E. Humphreys of the Corps of Engineers was chosen alternate. Here, Wilbur is checking the engine, and here he is with Lom standing in front, and the taller Humphreys at the right. Their instruction began October 8, with training periods of about 5 minutes each. The pupils were taught how to start the engine by pulling down on the outer blades of the propellers. Both students made good progress, and on October 26, each soloed. Humphrey first for 13 minutes, followed by Lom for 40 minutes. Thereafter, the flights of both students were to increase their skill and confidence. Lieutenant Foloy returned from France to College Park on April 20, hoping to receive training. He had three instruction flights from Wilbur and several more from Humphreys, but did not solo at that time. A flight on October 27 is particularly noteworthy. Early that morning, Mrs. Ralph Van Diemen, a friend of Catherine Wright, was taken for a flight by Wilbur. She thus became the first woman in America to fly in an airplane. On November 3rd, Lom carried his first passenger, a close friend, Lieutenant George Cook Sweet, who thus became the first United States naval officer to fly in a heavier-than-air craft. 2 days later, during a turn in the air, the left wing struck the ground, and there was some damage caused, so the flights at College Park ended at that time. Now, in the peculiar way that the War Department of those days acted, and the Defense Department of today sometimes does, the decision was made that Lom should go back to the cavalry, and Humphrey should go back to the engineers, and Benny Foloy, who hadn't sold it at all, was told to take the airplane to Texas and teach himself to fly and use it in connection with the artillery and cavalry and infantry there. En route, he stopped off at Chicago to assemble the airplane during an electrical exposition. Incidentally, radio was installed in it, and that was the first installation I've heard of radio in an airplane. Then he went on down to Fort Sam Houston. The airplane was assembled there. By the end of February, the airplane was ready for test, the catapult tower and the track laid out. Lieutenant Foloy made his first flight there on March 2. This was also his first solo and lasted 7.5 minutes. It was followed by three other flights of 11, 21, and 15 minutes. But on the last flight, engine failure forced him to glide down. Leveling off too soon, he suffered a pancake landing. As he described the experience, he said he made his first solo takeoff, his first solo flight, his first landing, and his first crack-up all the same day. He had competent help in his group of enlisted men. Here they are, the entire United States Air Force of 1910. Eugene Simmons, who was in this group, was the first civilian airplane mechanic for the Army. He's the chap in the shirt sleeves there in the back row over at your left. We have him to thank for two of these pictures, including this one showing the wheels, which, under Lieutenant Floyd's direction, Simmons contrived so as to eliminate the use of the catapult tower and rail, which was required to be relayed every time the wind changed direction. At about the same time, July of 1910, the Wright brothers were conducting similar experiments with wheels, the first public use being at the Asbury Park, New Jersey flight demonstrations in August. During this period, Congress had not appropriated any money for operation of the airplane unit, and often it was kept in service only by ingenious and economical repairs accomplished by the hangar crew. Gasoline was sometimes purchased out of Foloi's own salary. To help with this awkward situation, Robert J. Collier, who had been the first person to buy an airplane from the Wright brothers, and who was then president of the Aero Club of America, generously lent his airplane to the Army. Mr. Collier is ever remembered for his donation of the trophy now named for him, which is awarded annually by the National Aeronautic Association for the greatest achievement in aeronautics or astronautics, the value of which has been demonstrated by a year of practical use. The Collier airplane differed from the Signal Corps No. 1 airplane in the location of its elevator and in the method of control. Here it is with its handling crew. The Wright company sent one of its commercial pilots, Philip Parmalee, to assist Lieutenant Foloi in adjusting to the new machine. On one occasion, Foloi was forced to make a landing on a company street and narrowly missed the tent of Captain Douglas MacArthur, later the renowned general, hero of both World Wars and the Korean War. In 1911, the Army decided to send old number one back to the Wright factory for a general overhaul and the incorporation of features which had been developed since its original manufacture. But meanwhile, at the Smithsonian, they had been trying to obtain an example of the Wright airplane for exhibition in the National Museum. Because the original Wright Flyer of 1903 had not been repaired following its damage by the wind after its fourth flight on December 17, 1903, and because the Wright military flyer was already government property and had acquired notable individual fame, the decision was reached by the Army to transfer it to the museum. There it can be seen today, unchanged since its original installation. The Wright factory, established in 1909 in Dayton, Ohio, was by this time very active in the production of airplanes. In the wood shop, selected ash was cut to size and length for the spars, and choice straight grain spruce was sawn and planed into strips and blocks to form the ribs, and into longer pieces from which the struts and braces and outer booms were formed. The wings were sewn at first from muslin, but by late 1910, a rubberized cotton was found to be impermeable to air and resistant to dampness. At first, the wing covering was single surfaced with sleeves for the ribs, but by 1911, the wings were double surfaced. The fabric was applied diagonally to give extra bracing against twisting. The Wrights designed and made the engines for their airplanes, the type used in 1910-11 having four upright cylinders developing about 30 horsepower. The Type A airplane with the elevator in front had by this time been replaced by the Type B. Its elevator was at the rear, and better stabilization resulted. Here is a Type B being assembled on the shop floor. Also in 1910 and continuing throughout the period of the Wright Company until 1916, schools were established in Dayton, in Montgomery, Alabama during the winter months, and on Long Island. The first student to solo was Walter Brookins, who continued to be one of the most skillful of the Wright pilots. This ground trainer was used for acquainting the students with the manipulation of the controls for directional steering, climb and descent, and lateral balance. This shows the extent to which the wings could be warped in order to bank the airplane, That is to raise one wing high when making a turn to prevent skidding outward. Warping was also used to restore balance. Meanwhile, by midsummer of 1909, a remarkable demonstration occurred which drew the attention of the world, momentarily at least, away from the accomplishments of the Wright brothers. The flight of Louis Bleriot of France in an airplane of his own design from France to England showed that other persons and other nations were mastering the art and science of flight. This flight also demonstrated that the monoplane or single-winged airplane had individual merit, distinctive from the biplane-winged engines of the Wrights. Toward the end of the next month, pilots from all over the world were gathering at Reims, France, for the international aviation events. America was represented by Glenn Curtis, another great man of whom I will tell you later. The Wright brothers could not participate because they were busy with their military contracts, but they were represented by some whom they had taught to fly. Now, Curtis won that international speed event on the 29th of August. His speed, the fastest of all, was 47 miles an hour. But because he had won that event, America became the host for the next year. And this is the airplane the Wright brothers built to compete for the James Gordon Bennett race of 1910. As we resume our story with the next section of this story of the Wright brothers, I'll tell you more about this airplane and then carry on. We have come to that time when, although the Wright brothers in 1903 had invented the airplane, in 1904, 5, 6, 7, and 8 had improved it, and in 1909 were still ahead of most others, by 1910, others in the world had developed airplanes, some of them very interesting, very efficient, such as this Antoinette airplane with Hubert Latham, its principal pilot. In this part of our story, we will be telling not only what the Wright brothers themselves were doing, but also what was accomplished by persons whom they had taught to fly and others who were flying the right type of airplane. The great prize for airplane speed in 1910 was the James Gordon Bennett Trophy, which had been won for America in 1909 by Glenn Curtis, thus making America the host for 1910. As I concluded part three of our story, I showed you this Wright racer, which had been designed and built especially to keep this prize in America. It was named the Baby Grand. Orville, here at the controls, had flown it at a speed of almost 70 miles per hour, faster than the known speed of any other entry. Its eight-cylinder engine weighed about 300 pounds, 100 pounds more than the usual four-cylinder types, and developed over 50 horsepower. Now look at the size of those propellers. I think they must be around 10 feet in diameter. The wingspan was only 22 feet, almost half that of the Kitty Hawk Flyer. Here's a final engine test. Now, there were no brakes in those days, and they hadn't used wheel chocks yet. I remember back in the old early bird times, it was customary for someone to holler, "More beef!" Then everyone would run to give a hand, and here you see they're holding it back so that the engine can be tried out. Also, sometimes we used to fasten a spring balance to the tail and then tie that to a post so we could measure the pull. Walter Brookins, the first person taught to fly by the Wright brothers, was to pilot the Baby Grand in this race. But to the great disappointment of many, particularly Wilbur and Orville, the engine up there at Belmont Park cut out at the critical time, and Brookins smashed into a bad landing. He crawled out of the wreck, but America's best hopes to win the race were lost. The English flyer, Claude Graham White, flying a 100-horsepower French Bleriot monoplane, won at a speed of 61 miles per hour. There were a total of 9 entrants from 3 nations, America, England, and France. Arch Hoxie, also flying a small-span Wright airplane but with a 30-horsepower engine, attained an altitude of about 7,000 feet at Belmont on October 27. On that day, the wind was so strong that his flyer and that of Ralph Johnston were blown backward while still facing forward. On the last day of the meet, October 31, Johnston established a world altitude record of 9,714 feet. Another famous air meet during the fall of 1910 was held at St. Louis.
There, Arch Hoxie took Theodore Roosevelt for a flight. He was the first person who had been president of the United States to fly in an airplane. As they landed and Teddy put back his wide-brimmed felt hat, he probably said, "That was bully." Air Express was inaugurated on November 7, 1910, when Phil Parmalee flew a Wright airplane from Sims Station near Dayton to Columbus, Ohio, carrying a package of silk consigned to the Morehouse Martins Company. The cargo weighed about 100 pounds and was valued at $800. His flight clothing consisted of an undershirt, a sweater coat, a heavy top coat, woolen cap, and goggles. The 65-mile flight was made in 66 minutes. Parmalee carried one piece of airmail. And the crowd that welcomed, they were so amused because he had such a hard time getting through all of this clothing and finally finding that letter to give it to Max Morehouse. Now, also in 1910, the world had become greatly interested in aviation, and everyone in America, among other nations, wanted to see airplanes in flight. So the Wright brothers organized an exhibition team. The person there with a derby hat, we used to call it an iron hat, is Roy Nabenshue, famous balloonist and dirigible airship pilot. He headed up the team, and Parmalee, we just met, he's there at the left. There's Walter Brookins at the right. There were many persons in that team. Now, Frank Coffin was another member of that team. There he is with Wilbur, Wilbur being at the right, another iron hat. Frank was a very capable pilot, but also there at the Wright School in Dayton, he was in charge of instruction. He's given to the museum the sheets that were used at that time to tabulate the accomplishments of the pilots. I hope we can raise this picture a bit and see those high-button shoes. Those are a classic thing of those days. I remember how proud I was of mine. Took me quite a while to button them up with my mother's old-fashioned button hook. Well, Frank was a splendid person and was one of the first to use floats on a Wright Type B airplane. This remarkable picture was taken in February of 1912. He was flying at New York, and he would have to somehow, you see that tugboat has made a path through the ice. He took off by dodging these cakes of ice and flew over part of the city and also flew over the Statue of Liberty, taking some photographs of it at the time. Another pilot of Wright-type planes was George Gray, who made numerous exhibition flights in the middle Atlantic states, particularly in Virginia. Later, when he was a pilot in World War I, he was so very proud of this license in which he could show that he'd learned to fly on Wright Brothers airplanes. I knew most of these men. I value my friendship with them. I wish I could tell more about the wonderful early bird friends that I have. There's an organization, you know, of the old timers, Early Birds. It was my privilege to be the recent president of it. Now, there were some girls who learned to fly, also of the Wright planes. There's Catherine Stinson, standing with her Wright plane. She learned to fly at Chicago and was taught to fly by Max Lilly. She thrilled many crowds in those cities over which she flew. Her sister, Marjorie, was also famous. They taught their brother, Eddie Stinson, to fly. Another brother, Jack, was also a pilot and maintained a flight school on Long Island. During World War I, Marjorie trained many Canadian pilots who fought in that war. Ruth Law was another girl flyer who learned the right system of control. Her cross-country flight in 1918 from Chicago to New York was a record maker. And during the First World War, she encouraged bond sales by advertising them from the sky. Now, Al Welsh, shown here at the left, had been one of the first three students taught to fly by Orville Wright. The other two were Brookins and Hoxie. Welsh's most famous pupil is shown here, Lieutenant Henry H. Arnold, later General of the Air Force. I always bow a bit to Hap. It was through him that I met my dear wife. And we always go over to his grave on Memorial Day and lay a few flowers there in appreciation. We're certainly a happy couple, and I'm so grateful to say so. Now, Hap had begun his lessons on May 3rd, 1911. The flight lasted 7 minutes, and on the report sheet, Welch wrote, "Rough." Some bad landings, I guess. The third lesson was for 12 minutes, and the comment was hand on elevator, meaning that the teacher let the pupil steer the airplane up and down. During lesson number 9, Arnold was permitted to try balancing the airplane, and on lesson number 19, the comment was landed without assistance. The final notation was number of flights, 28. Total time in the air, 3 hours, 43 minutes. Finished 13 May, 10 days learning. Actually, it was 11 days, but the Wright brothers didn't permit any flying on Sunday. They were the sons of Bishop Wright, you recall. Arnold's companion in training was Lieutenant Tommy Milling. Now, there's Hap at the left and Tommy seated there in the airplane. Milling's teacher was Cliff Turpin. Here's Cliff in his airplane at the center of this group. The picture was taken when the minister at the right was marrying the couple at the left. Then Turpin took the bridal couple up for a short aerial honeymoon. There were all kinds of aviation thrills and stunts in those pioneer days. In June of 1911, the Army established its first aviation field at College Park, Maryland, the same field where Wilbur had taught the Army's first two pilots in 1909, as I described in my previous section of this series. There, the Army quartermaster constructed these hangars, which had been designed by the Wrights, and Arnold, Milling, and other officers, pilots, and men were assigned to conduct military flight operations there. Arnold was a very active pilot. On July 7, he made an altitude flight of 3,260 feet. On July 10, he flew over the United States Capitol building. On July 18, he climbed to 4,167 feet. And on August 21, he made a cross-country flight of 42 miles to Frederick, Maryland. By this time, an increase of appropriations for aeronautics to $125,000 for the fiscal year 1912 had permitted the purchase of several airplanes of both the Wright and Curtiss types. Bomb dropping in those days was a simple procedure. You just picked it up, held it out, and let it go. Here at San Francisco in 1910, Lieutenant Myron Crissy had assembled a bomb from some 2.5-inch pipe and made another one from an artillery shell. With Phil Parmalee as pilot, Crissy dropped them from a Wright airplane over the Tanforan racetrack. These were the first live aerial bombs. But at College Park, a more scientific method was developed by Lieutenant Riley Scott. His invention carried two 18-pound bombs and included a telescope for measuring speed, an altimeter for measuring height, a stopwatch for precise timing, and tabulations for figuring equations. These tables were prepared for an altitude of 400 feet, and from that height, the bombs landed within 10 feet of a target that was 4 by 5 feet on the ground. Scott, whose pilots for these tests had been Tommy Milling, prepared tabulations for an altitude of 3,000 feet. But before he could make those tests at College Park, he had to leave for France. Our own War Department had not shown much interest, but the French had offered a prize for bomb dropping, and Scott was going to try to win it. In fact, there he did win the recognition he deserved. Now, James Means of Boston, whom you'll recall from a previous talk, was compiler of the aeronautical annuals of 1895, 6, and 7. The Wright brothers had studied those and had continued their interest in aviation from that time. Means also was interested in aviation, and in 1909 was granted a patent for a signaling device. It used the exhaust of the engine to blow through a tube in which lamp black was inserted by tapping a key, something like a telegraph, whereby dots and dashes of the Morse code could be blown out as visual signals. This was also tested at College Park, October 13, 1911. The official report was, because of the short time of the visibility of the puffs and the impossibility of distinguishing the same at a distance greater than 4 or 5 miles, it is thought that the device is not practical for general military use. On June 7, 1912, Captain Chandler, who was in charge of the air station at College Park, tested a Lewis machine gun for the first time from the air. Lieutenant Milling was his pilot. Using a drum with 50 cartridges firing at the rate of 500 shots a minute, 5 hits were made on a strip of cheesecloth 6 by 7 feet in size from an altitude of 250 feet. Other shots were fired into a pond to give the gunner a better idea of the spacing of the bullets. The next day, from an altitude of 550 feet, some 44 shots were fired. 14 of them hit a cloth target on the ground. The target was 2 yards by 18 yards in size. The gunner was handicapped by the lack of sights on his gun, and also it was very difficult to maneuver, to aim, to turn the gun because of the limited connection there of it. Moreover, the War Department was not particularly impressed by this. They said the purpose of the airplane is for reconnaissance duty only, and it is those young officers out at College Park who have these rather ridiculous and fanciful ideas that gunnery will ever be used during air combats. You see, the War Department still had to learn a few things. In October of 1911, Orville Wright went back to Kitty Hawk to conduct some tests in gliding under the very favorable conditions that prevail there. He was anxious particularly to develop some kind of an automatic stabilizer. In fact, he'd been working on that since 1907. He had with him there at Kitty Hawk his brother, Lauren, his nephew, Horace, and their friend, Alec Ogilvy of England. Their first job upon arrival at the old camp was to patch up the hangar and arrange housekeeping details. The gliding tests continued for most of the month, with various modifications made in the aircraft, at times using some parts from the old machine of 1905, which they had left there. The most notable performance was on October 24, when about 20 glides were made, ranging from 1 minute to a world record of 9 minutes and 45 seconds. Now that's hovering, you see, remaining motionless, pretty much motionless over one spot. Marvelous accomplishment. This record was not exceeded until 1921, when Germany, you see, had been prevented from flying powered aircraft and then turned to gliding to keep up their flying proficiency. And then they did finally surpass that 9 minute record. But this stood for about 10 years. Also in October 1911, another air meet was being held in St. Louis. One of the features was the carrying of mail by airplane. Walter Brookins, here seated on the skid, was the pilot. This was the second instance of official airplane mail in America. The first had occurred the previous month at the Nassau Boulevard Long Island Air Meet when Earl Ovington, wearing the crash helmet, had received the bag of mail from the Postmaster General himself. Frank Hitchcock, the Postmaster General, gave me this picture several years ago. Now at St. Louis, second Assistant Postmaster General Granfield officiated. He's the gray-haired gentleman. The date of October 4 is confirmed by this piece of mail addressed to A.B. Lambert, one of the most enthusiastic patrons of aviation in those pioneer days, later became one of the St. Louis sponsors of Charles Lindbergh's transatlantic flight. Incidentally, there's a penny postcard. You don't see them anymore. Now, here's Mr. Lambert with Walter Brookins. One of the most notable pilots of Wright airplanes on cross-country flights was Harry Atwood. His world record accomplishment for 1911 was from St. Louis to New York City, a distance of 1,266 miles, made with 19 intermediate stops in 12 days. A Wright Type B, made by the Burgess Company under license, was used and required no major repairs en route. It was the same airplane he had used in a flight from Boston to Atlantic City, New Jersey. Soon after that flight, Atwood learned that the Aero Club of Washington had awarded him its gold medal. The Aero Club of America also recognized that flight. The medal was to be presented by the President of the United States, then William Howard Taft. To receive it, Atwood flew to Washington and landed on the southern lawn of the White House, believe it or not. When I told one of our President's helicopter pilots about this flight and this landing, the helicopter pilot refused to believe it until I showed him this picture. He thought only helicopters could sit down in the backyard of the White House. Then when I said that Atwood took off from the same limited space after receiving the medal, as verified by this photograph, the president's pilot finally gave in, but he pointed out that the trees were not as tall then as they are now. But the greatest flight of 1911, and in fact one of the most notable of all time, was accomplished by this pilot, Calbraith Perry Rogers. He loved to fly and he loved a cigar too. He not only exceeded Atwood's distance record, but became the first person to fly an airplane all the way from coast to coast across the United States of America. Rogers was the descendant of famous Americans. His father was a captain in the United States Army and fought in the Indian Wars. Roger's great-grandfather was Commodore Matthew Calbraith Perry, who had sailed his squadron into Japanese waters, inviting that nation to engage in commerce with America back in the 1860s. Roger's granduncle was Captain Oliver Hazard Perry, hero of the Battle of Lake Erie in the War of 1812. Cal had hoped to be a naval officer, but was prevented by an air condition. Becoming interested in aviation when he visited his cousin, John Rogers, of the Navy, while that officer was detailed to the Wright School for flight instruction, Cal decided to also take lessons. He soloed in the remarkable time of 90 minutes instruction. He attracted national attention 2 months later during the 9-day air meet held in Chicago when he won the award for the most time in the air, flying every day for a total of 27 hours. Now, back in those romantic days of the early birds, there were various prizes offered for flights from one city to another. Remember that Curtis got the one from Albany to New York, and then Hamilton got the one from New York to Philadelphia in return. But then William Randolph Hearst of the Hearst newspapers was going to clobber all those lesser prizes of around $5,000 and $10,000 with a $50,000 prize. Now, $50,000 was a heck of a lot of money then. It still is to a museum curator, I assure you. But $50,000 for the first flight from coast to coast, all the way in either direction. It had to be done, however, in 30 days. Now, Cal Rogers was among those who were determined to win that prize. The others, oh, they cracked up or gave up, but he kept on. He took off from Sheepshead Bay, Long Island, on September 17, from Sheepshead Bay, Long Island. His airplane was a Wright Type EX, single-seated with a 35-horsepower four-cylinder engine. He flew right over New York City. Now, can you imagine sitting on a board seat, no safety belt, your feet stick out on a little piece of about 2x2, or less than that, wood, to brace your feet on. You look down at all those skyscrapers reaching up at you. He flew right over New York City, but then he spotted on the New Jersey tracks this white-painted car. Now, that says Vin Fizz. Vin Fizz was a drink, now not Gin Fizz, Vin Fizz was a drink sold for 5 cents, put out by the Armour Company, who were meat packers, so I don't know what they put in the drink. They said it had grapes in it. But they were paying part of his expenses, $5 a mile. And this was one of a train of cars. This had his spare parts in it, had another airplane, had a spare engine. His wife was in there. I didn't mean to say she was a spare part. No, she rode in the Pullman car. It was also a diner. There was this train that accompanied him. And sometimes he'd catch up to the train, sometimes the train would catch up to him. Now here is Cal landing at Middletown, New York. That was his first stop, a wonderful flight. He said it was a good landing because it didn't knock the ashes off the end of his cigar. He'd flown 84 miles in 105 minutes. Now here he holds up his only instrument. That's a piece of string. It was a corset string, his wife donated that. But that was fastened to a wire in front of him, and it would wave at him. And if it waved to right or left, he knew that he was drifting side to side. If it waved up or down, he knew that he was climbing or descending. It's a very good instrument, but that's all he had. No compass at all. Nothing but that little piece of line. Now, taking off from Middletown the next morning, his wheels brushed the top of a tree, and he landed in a chicken yard. That's no place to set it down. Repairs took 3 days. You must realize he had no advanced weather reports, no compass, no accurate information about the route ahead, only the railroad tracks to guide him, and sometimes he took the wrong switch. He flew on. His route lay across New York State, a corner of Pennsylvania, into Ohio, Indiana, Chicago. Then he turned southward because he knew he couldn't get over the high Rockies, through Missouri, Kansas, Oklahoma, Texas. He had more than a dozen serious crack-ups, some real washouts. But with the help of his mechanics, he kept on. Charlie Taylor was sometimes sent to help him from the Wright Company there in Dayton. As he got to Texas, there was an eagle there that disputed Cal's right to invade those skies. Also in Texas, he met Bob Fowler, who was trying to win the Hearst Prize by flying from California to the East Coast. Fowler eventually reached the Florida coast near Jacksonville. That was the next year. It took him 122 days. As I stand here, the record is 123 minutes, same distance, a B-58. But now we're back in 1911. After 49 days, Rogers arrived at his official destination, That was Pasadena, California. Here he received enthusiastic acclaim, as you can see. He had exceeded the 30-day stipulation, so he didn't get the prize. Nobody got the prize. Sort of a dirty trick, I think, but he did get the American flag around his shoulders, and that's a good enough prize for anybody. But now he wanted to take off and actually reach the Pacific coast. Here he is. He's going to go about 15 miles onto Long Beach. But over Compton, his engine quit, and he really pranged it down. He landed head first in a plowed field. Both legs were broken, also his collarbone, and he had a brain concussion, was unconscious for 24 hours. He was in the hospital a month. But then with his good wife's help, now that's Mabel at the left, his mother has on that rather large hat. But then they got him out in a wheelchair. He got on board a pair of crutches. He hobbled over to his beloved Vin Fizz, which had been repaired by his faithful crew. An enormous crowd awaited him at Long Beach. And there, sure enough, he landed and rolled those wheels in the surf of the Pacific. This was a glorious moment. He had flown from coast to coast in 84 days, a distance of 4,320 miles the way he flew it. The first person to cross the United States of America by air. He was fated back and forth, banquets on the East Coast, the West Coast, but finally he returned to California, and then on April 3rd, he was giving an exhibition flight over Long Beach in his Wright B. He flew over a pier, and there was a bunch of seagulls that rose up rather frightened. One of them jammed itself into the controls, and down went Cal. He did not walk away from this one. He died April 3, 1912. Today, in the National Air and Space Museum, in this old tin shed, and I'll put in a plug for a new building because this is the most permanent temporary building in Washington, there is the Vin Fizz Flyer, restored by the Smithsonian crew, a wonder to everyone who sees it, this marvelous aircraft that did make the first coast-to-coast flight. Another development in 1911 is especially pertinent to this series of talks that we're giving. There's the Navy's first air station, and there is the Wright Type B, there at Greenbury Point, Maryland, across the Severn River from Annapolis. Lieutenant Rogers, who was Cal Rogers' cousin, had been taught to fly at the Wright Brothers School, and was sent there to fly the plane. There's John Rogers in the foreground. With the showing of this picture, I want to identify and thank the sailor in the white cap. He is Dale Ziegler, by whose kindness I obtained these pictures of the B-1. I'll speak about him further in our next program. The B-1 was operated either as a land plane or a seaplane. Here is one configuration with two floats. And here, one float only is used, with the addition of wingtip floats to keep it balanced in rough water. Flights were made in the B-1 to Baltimore and to other areas of the Chesapeake. And then in December, with wintry weather making flying difficult, the aviators at Greenbury Point were ordered to transfer with their equipment to North Island, San Diego, California. There, the dear old B-1 finally was washed out. Here is how a naval aviator kept his feet dry when going ashore from his aircraft, riding piggyback on some sailor. The dear old B-1, as I said, was finally washed out after about 2 years of service, but we're so grateful that one piece of it has been preserved, and that's the engine that you see here on this model. I'll tell you about that in our next program. I think it's a wonderful story, thanks to the foresight of the Navy, thanks a bit to the museum. We have kept it, and it's a wonderful part, the oldest relic of naval aviation.
When we were previously together, I told you of the Wright B-1, which was the first Wright-type airplane made for the United States Navy. I showed you this scale model, explained that the airplane itself had been washed out since 1912 when it pranged into Chesapeake Bay, but one significant part of it has been preserved, and that is the engine. I want to show that to you.
This is the oldest relic of United States Naval Aviation. It is a Wright Brothers engine of 1911, about 35 horsepower. It was installed in the Wright B-1, which was a biplane. Had an upper wing and a lower wing, biplane. This is the front end of the engine. This is the rear end. That is, the airplane went that away. And on the front end is this water pump driven by these gears. On this plate was mounted the magneto. Unfortunately, that was not preserved, but we're so glad that the engine itself was preserved by the Navy. The magneto was mounted here, and from the distributor unit of the magneto, wires extended to these four spark plugs. The magneto could be rocked mechanically by an arm so as to reduce the speed somewhat, but there was no throttle as such. You took off wide open, you flew wide open. You could slack off a little bit by rocking the magneto for coming in for a landing, but then to stop the engine, there was a compression wire that extended right in front of the pilot and to this lever, so that as this was moved, it would hold up the exhaust valve and thus stop the compression in the engine. On the back end is this flywheel. On this shaft, there was mounted a double sprocket, and from this double sprocket, chains extended to the propellers, the two pusher propellers, to the port and starboard sides. Those revolved in opposite directions. We are positive that this is the engine of the B-1. In 1957, I was in San Diego, and there I met Dale Sigler, who told me that he was the Navy's first aviation mechanic. And I told him about this engine. He said, if I could see it, I could identify it. So he was brought to Washington, shown the engine. He said, yes, that is the engine of the B-1, because when I was working as a mechanic at the Navy's first air station, which was Greenbury Point, Maryland, across the Severn River from the Naval Academy, I put this patch on the crankcase. And so by his own handiwork, he identified this as the actual engine of 1911. This is the oldest relic of United States Naval Aviation. On Memorial Day, May 30, 1912, the world was shocked and grieved to learn of the death of Wilbur Wright early that morning. It was known that he had contracted a severe case of typhoid fever, but reports led his friends to believe that he was recovering. But he suffered a relapse and died peacefully at home in Dayton, Ohio. Persons throughout the world who had known this kind, capable, unassuming, quiet gentleman mourned his loss. This photograph was made in France in 1908 when Wilbur was demonstrating the Wright airplane there. And this is a painting made from life in France by the French artist Hervé Mathey. It was given to the National Air and Space Museum by Wilbur's close friend and mine, General Frank P. Lahm, and his sister. This is one of the best photographs of Wilbur and is inscribed by him to his friend, Léon Boulay, who helped arrange for Wilbur's demonstration flights in France. I sort of like this one best. Wilbur had brought this kite from France to the son of Frank Coffin. Frank was an important member of the Wright exhibition team. It looks as though Wilbur and Frank are having more fun than the boy with the kite. The Wright brothers loved children, but never married. The other two Wright brothers, Lauren and Ruchlin, did have families. Orville was, of course, the one most saddened by the death of his beloved brother and companion. The marvelous combination of their minds and skills, which had brought to the world the first successful, powered, controlled, and manned airplane, was severed by Wilbur's death. Orville found some comfort in carrying on the projects upon which Wilbur and he had been engaged. Orville was a superb pilot, and the exhilaration of flying helped to ease his sorrow. This airplane is one of the Wright racing and exhibition types. It was known as the Roadster, sometimes abbreviated as the R. It is interesting, educational, and impressive for us to realize how far the Wright brothers advanced in the design of the airplane. With the exception of the R and the EX and the Baby Grand, they identified their types alphabetically. I'll remind you of the first two, the A, which had the elevator in front, and the B, which had the elevator in the rear. That's the rear view of the B. Now, the C was intended for military use
and was stronger and therefore somewhat heavier than the bee. Its airfoil had less curvature, and it could lift heavier loads and climb faster than previous types. The most visible difference in appearance was the use of vertical vanes in front instead of the triangular form as in the B, E, X, and R. The C had a six-cylinder engine which produced about 50 to 60 horsepower instead of the 35 horsepower in the four-cylinder engines. It was the C which was used by Lieutenants Arnold, Milling, and their fellow officer pilots at College Park, Maryland in 1912. Here is a float-equipped version of the C, known as the CH, the H designating the hydro-aeroplane type. Note the steps in the bottom of the floats. They break open the suction that often prevents seaplanes from getting unstuck from the water. Orville had noticed that in some maneuvers during flights in the CH, the two long parallel floats seemed to interfere with the flow of air to the wing. And after further experimenting, he preferred this single float of rectangular shape, as you're about to see in the next slide. Early in 1912, the Signal Corps requested from the Wright brothers a proposal and bid for the lights for a light scout machine. It was to carry one person, have a speed of 65 miles per hour, climb at 1,800 feet in 3 minutes, have a 3-hour gasoline capacity, and be easily transportable by road or rail. For this airplane, the Wright's bid of $6,000 was accepted. The airplane, known as the Wright D, was delivered to College Park that summer. That's Tommy Milling at the controls. The first single-propellered airplane produced by the Wrights was Type E. It had a wingspan of 32 feet and weighed 730 pounds without the pilot. Orville enjoyed flying this one. Type F was made for the Army in 1913 and was the first Wright airplane to have an enclosed fuselage. It was powered with a European Austro-Daimler engine of 90 horsepower. Here, a group of soldiers are holding it back while the pilot revs up the engine. In the side view, you can see the Army's number 39 on the rudder. Now, I want to interrupt our alphabetical sequence by inserting an item which will be in chronological order, but in view of the extensive use and importance today of automatic piloting, it is impressive evidence of Orville Wright's foresight and genius. Almost from the very beginning of their experiments, Orville had been interested in developing an apparatus for automatically stabilizing and controlling an airplane. The equipment shown here represents about 8 years of development. These pictures were taken in the winter of 1913. A Type C airplane was used. The group witnessing the flights was a committee assigned by the Aero Club of America to judge the effectiveness of the apparatus. Orville made both straight and circling flights, demonstrating the absolute reliability of the system, and as a final proof that his invention was practical, flew toward the judges with his hands raised high above the control levers. As a final gesture, he tapped the rudder control, whereupon the airplane commenced a wide turn and continued on that course until Orville took over control and brought the airplane into a landing. For the development of this stabilizer, Orville Wright received the Robert J. Collier Trophy. In May of 1914, he delivered a lecture on the stability of airplanes at the Franklin Institute in Philadelphia. The Smithsonian reprinted that text. In 1913, Orville engaged the services of Grover Learning. He was the first graduate in America of an aeronautical engineering course, earning his Master of Arts degree at Columbia University, New York City in 1910. Having participated in the design and development of a glider flying boat as early as April 1909, and having made and flown a flying boat in 1912, he brought to the Wright Company a knowledge of seaplanes, very important for the further developments. This is the Wright Brothers airboat of 1913, the Type G. It had oars near the wingtips to aid in making turns on the narrow river. The hull was framed of ash and spruce covered with sheet metal, treated to prevent corrosion. The span was 38 feet and net weight 1,200 pounds. Its six-cylinder engine was located behind the pilot and passenger who sat side by side. In the next type of airboat, the horizontal elevator was raised high above the outriggers to avoid the spray. The engine was in the bow of the hull, the drive shaft extending aft between the seats to the double sprocket by which the chains to the propellers were driven. Here are Orville and Oscar Brindley, who was one of the most capable pilots in the Wright organization. Airboats were purchased and flown by a number of pilots, including Harry Atwood and Ernest Hall, who flew them principally on the rivers and lakes of Ohio. Type H resembled the F and was brought out in 1914. The span was 38 feet and weight 1,150 pounds. Its fuselage was of wood covered with canvas. It was rated to carry a useful load of 1,000 pounds and to have a speed of 56 miles per hour. A shorter winged version of the H was known as the HS. It had a somewhat better speed and rate of climb. Note that by 1915, the form of control had changed from the two-lever system to a wheel. This wheel could be turned to right or left so as to balance the airplane. It could be pushed for descent, pulled back to climb, and then on the side of the wheel, on the right side, was a sector that moved on the shaft, and that was moved up and down to activate the rudder. It was a very good control. In my opinion, it's the best of the seven types of control that were produced during the history of the Wright Brothers experiments. Now, according to a letter written by Orville in 1943, there was no Type I produced by the Wright Company. But they had meanwhile licensed the Burgess Company in Massachusetts to make airplanes, and the Type I was the Burgess copy of the Wright Type B, used notably by Harry Atwood when he made his wonderful flight to the backyard of the White House back there in 1912. Another pilot of the Burgess type was my good friend Roy Waite, who barnstormed in the Middle Atlantic states. Other forms using the Wright type of wings were produced by Burgess, who also developed some original designs. This aeroboat, you will notice, has a long hull extending from the bow to the rudder. Previous types had the short hull with the outriggers. But this was identified as Type J. It was operated on the Hudson River, carrying passengers for hire. Note that it was equipped with hydrofoils beside the hull, both sides, to assist in takeoff. Now, Type K was developed for the Navy in 1915. It was a departure from conventional Wright designs. The propellers were in front of the wing. The lateral balance was effected by ailerons instead of by wing warping, and the rudder was rounded instead of rectangular. The cylindrical floats originally supplied from the Wright factory were unsatisfactory and were replaced by those designed by Captain Holden C. Richardson of the Navy and manufactured by Burgess. They improved takeoff and alighting. The K was the last Wright type to have the bent-end propellers, which had been used since 1908. The final design produced by the Wright Company was the L of 1915-16. It was a further departure from the original Wright types. It had a single propeller in front of a covered fuselage with a cockpit behind the wing. It had ailerons and wheel control. The speed range was 25 to 80 miles per hour and climb about 650 feet per minute. It was intended to meet military requirements for high-speed scouting. But, as you see, it was very much below the performance of types then being used in the European War. That war had been raging for 2 years, and under the pressure of combat, a number of advanced designs had been developed. By the time the L was produced, Orville Wright's active direction of the original Wright Company became terminated. With the war in Europe intensifying, some American manufacturers received contracts for military supplies. The financiers and businessmen who had taken over operation of the Wright Company arranged a merger with a firm established by Glenn Martin. That's Martin there in the picture with Orville. The resultant organization being known as the Wright Martin Aircraft Corporation. They were attending an air show there in 1917.
One of the principal undertakings of the new corporation was to obtain rights to manufacture the French Hispano-Suiza engines, which were urgently needed for British and French fighter airplanes. They obtained the facilities of the former Simplex Automobile Company, which was up there in New Jersey. And not only did they make good copies of the French engine, but also they improved the manufacturing methods. Early in 1917, Orville served as consulting engineer to a new organization there in Dayton called the Dayton Airplane Company. They established a flying field for training on the outskirts of the city, and they developed a very good trainer, which was called the FS, because it flew successfully first shot. That was a really good ship. It had the Hispano engine of 150 horsepower there in the nose. With the entry of America into the war, April 6, 1917, the Dayton Wright Airplane Company was formed in that city, and Orville Wright became a director. Their first contract was for training planes, but following the decision of an official aircraft board that the British de Havilland IV airplane was the type that America should produce in quantity for combat service, the Dayton Wright Airplane Company received a contract to build 4,000 of them. An interior view shows the intensive production underway. And here, we see a vast number of fuselages awaiting their wings before shipment overseas. These airplanes were powered with the Liberty engine, that dear thing that I love so much, 400 horsepower, which was one of the major productions by America in World War I. Here is Orville Wright with the company's chief pilot, Howard Reinhardt, following a flight in the de Havilland IV. This airplane is now preserved by the National Air and Space Museum. A very significant and little-known development in World War I by America was the design and production of guided missiles, and in that project, Orville Wright had a vital part. Working with a group of engineers and manufacturers, including Boss Kettering, Virginius Clark, Harold Morehouse, and others, Orville participated prominently in the design of the wings, propeller, and other components. The Dayton Wright Messenger served as a manned airplane for testing the guided missiles. It had some qualities also as a private sport plane. It tested the de Palma engine. Sometimes these missiles were called aerial torpedoes, but the usual term was the bug. Successful test flights of the unmanned missiles were made, but the signing of the armistice on November 11, 1918 terminated the project. Post-war airplanes of the Dayton Wright Company include several modifications of the de Havillands, such as a company executive airplane and a similar one called the Honeymoon Express. With the closing of the war, the airplane industry became anxious to find ways to utilize its capabilities and resources. The James Gordon Bennett Trophy race had last been held in 1913 when it was won by France. But the war had suspended further contests. In 1920, the competition was reopened with France as the host, and America prepared four fast planes as entries. This one carried the hopes of the Dayton Wright Company. Orville Wright was much interested in it and apparently made wind tunnel studies of the design. I saw that model up at the Franklin Institute. This type was known as the RB-1, named for Reinhardt and Bowman of the Dayton Wright Company, who are here standing beside their entry. It was powered with a six-cylinder, 250-horsepower Hall-Scott or Liberty engine. Its wing could be varied in airfoil curvature. The landing gear was retractable. The cockpit was enclosed. The estimated speed was above 200 miles per hour. But regrettably, in the race, it did not perform at its best. A broken rudder cable necessitated the forced landing, and the pilot, Howard Reinhardt, realized that it was out of the race. Sadie Lacroix, in a French Newport, won at an average speed of 168.5 miles per hour. Thus, with its third consecutive win, France kept the trophy. The last airplane to be designed by Orville Wright was named with his initials, the OW. It was a three or four place cabin plane, here shown during its construction with part of the wing uncovered. The engine was a Wright Hispano of 150 horsepower. Benny Whalen, who had learned to fly at the Wright School, was its principal pilot. I again thank him for these photographs as I show them to you.
although no longer engaged in the production of aircraft, Orville retained a keen interest in aviation. Here he is, soon after World War I, with America's ace of aces, Eddie Rickenbacker, and Major Rudolph Schroeder, renowned test pilot, who was affectionately called Shorty, being about 6 feet five. In 1921, Orville watched his sister Catherine christen one of Grover Loening's air yachts, a type which won the Robert J. Collier Trophy for that year. In 1926, Orville was present with that same trophy was presented to Albert Reed for development of a metal propeller. At the left is Godfrey Cabot, then head of the National Aeronautic Association. General James Fache was chief of the Army Air Service next to him. Orville is standing beside Mr. Reed. After the war, the Wright-Martin Aircraft Corporation had been reorganized, becoming the Wright Aeronautical Corporation. Some of their most successful engines were designed by Charles Lawrence. Thus, the name Wright was often linked with various airplanes, which used this corporation's engines. But Orville had nothing to do with their design. Here's the Wright Balanca airplane, which was such a sensation at the 1925 National Air Races where I photographed it. It was the forerunner of the Balanca transatlantic airplanes, which thrilled the sensation-loving public in the latter 1920s, remember the Columbia. The Wright Whirlwind engine, which was an outstanding factor in the success of Charles Lindbergh's flight from New York to Paris, May 20, 1927, further perpetuated the name of Wright. Following Lindbergh's return to America and his receptions in Washington, New York, and St. Louis, his next wish was to pay his respects to the surviving brother of the two who first gave powered and controlled wings to mankind. The world record altitude flight of Apollo Suchek of our Navy on May 8, 1929, when he climbed to 39,140 feet, was in a Wright Apache airplane produced by the Wright Aeronautical Corporation, but powered with an engine made by Pratt & Whitney. A year later, Suchek set a new record of 43,166 feet with the same airplane. The Apache was one of the last types to carry the name Wright. Further examples of Orville Wright's continuing interest in aeronautical events and progress is his attendance at the International Aeronautic Conference that was held in 1928 in Washington. He is at the left. The group includes Henry Ford, Charles Lindbergh, Bill McCracken, A.P. Warner, and others. And here is Orville standing beside Porter Adams, who was president of the National Aeronautic Association. General Benny Folloy is there in the gray coat, chief of the Army Air Corps at that time. Now, during all this period, Orville Wright maintained his own laboratory in Dayton, conducting experiments in his wind tunnel, developing various mechanisms, constantly interested in learning more about the laws of aerodynamics. His final years were comfortable, with satisfying memories of worthwhile accomplishments. He had many friends, often inviting them to share his beautiful home, which he called Hawthorne Hill, in the residential part of Dayton. There on January 26, 1948, he decided he should fix the doorbell. Perhaps he overexerted himself. That afternoon, he suffered a heart attack at his laboratory. After a few days in the hospital, he died the evening of January 30, 1948. He is buried in the family plot in Dayton beside his beloved brother, Wilbur. Wilbur and Orville Wright received many honors. One of the first was the gold medal from the Aero Club of France. The Royal Aeronautic Society of Great Britain gave them its gold medal. The Smithsonian Institution gave them the first Langley Medal. The gold medal of the Aero Club of America was presented at the White House by William Howard Taft. Congress voted them a gold medal, which was given to them in Dayton. There are many memorials to the Wright brothers. The first was placed by the citizens of Kitty Hawk in front of the home of Captain Tate, where they assembled their first glider in 1900. At Le Mans, France, near where Wilbur made his astonishing flights in 1908, this monument was erected. And in southern France, where Wilbur continued his flying and instructed pupils in 1909, this monument was dedicated. The United States Navy named its first aircraft tender the USS Wright. At one time, her executive officer was DeWitt Clinton Ramsey. I had the privilege of knowing Admiral and Mrs. Ramsey. They established the Ramsey Fund for the National Air and Space Museum. The most famous memorial to the Wright brothers is their Wright flyer of 1903. To the gratification of all mankind, it has been preserved. It is the most treasured exhibit in the National Air and Space Museum. Displayed, as shown here, in the place of highest honor, together with Lindbergh's Spirit of St. Louis, the X-15, which is the world's most advanced experimental airplane, and the spacecraft Friendship 7, in which John Glenn became the first American to orbit the Earth. The most impressive monument to the Wright brothers is at the top of Killdevil Hill, about 4 miles south of Kitty Hawk, North Carolina. From the crest of this hill, they made their glides in 1901, 2, and 3, and from near its base, they made their first powered flights. The inscription around the base of this monument is particularly appropriate for us to recall as we come to the conclusion of our story of the Wright brothers. It is, in commemoration of the conquest of the air by the brothers Wilbur and Orville Wright, conceived by genius and achieved by dauntless resolution and unconquerable faith. I want to wrap it up by emphasizing 5 points that characterize the Wright brothers' accomplishments. First, they prepared the scientific data necessary for the design of a successful airplane. Second, they built that airplane. Third, they taught themselves to fly it. Fourth, they advanced the development of the airplane through no less than 30 designs, as I've shown you. And fifth, they taught others to fly. Surely nowhere else in the history of invention has a basic idea conceived by two men been carried forward so far. The story of Wilbur and Orville Wright.